So conflicts of interest disclosure, I had the study with Dr. Ye and Dr. Chang, the study about the balloon ring, but I'm not going to discuss any of it in this lecture. So objectives is to define the brain areas involved in wakefulness and explain the flip-flop switch model of sleep-wake pattern to determine clinical hypersomnolence diagnostic tests and causes, to compare the different alerting agents available based on mechanisms of action, pharmacokinetic safety profile, dosing, and ASM strength of recommendation. So the part in the brain that makes us awake and keeps us awake is the ARAS, the ascending reticular arousal system, which is composed of the ventral and the dorsal. So the dorsal part is includes the thalamus, LDT, PPT, the pons, and then the ventral part includes the lateral hypothalamus, tubulomammillary nucleus, dorsal raphe, locus coeruleus. So when you put them together, the dorsal and the ventral, it will look like this. So the basal forebrain, they produce the acetylcholine, and some of it produce GABA. Tubulomammillary nucleus produces the histamine. Substantia nigra and the VPAG produce the ventral periaqueductal gray, produces the dopamine. And then lateral hypothalamus is the one that produces orexin. Dorsal raphe produces the serotonin. Locus coeruleus produces the norepinephrine. And the lateral dorsal tegmentum, pedunculo, the LDT-PPT produces acetylcholine. So the flip-flop switch model, because in electrical engineering, if one thing is turned, there's like two sets of things. So if one is turned on, the other is automatically turned off, something like that. So just imagine like there's two seesaws here. And then this part is the sleep on neurotransmitter. The part of the brain that produces the neurotransmitters that make us sleep. The other side is the wake on. Areas in the brain that produces neurotransmitters that makes us awake or maintain wakefulness. And same thing on this, on the other seesaw is about the REM on cells and the REM off cells. So the orexin is the one that stabilizes these two seesaw. Meaning if there's orexin, so anything green here is actually stimulating, anything red kind of inhibits each other. Like this wake on cells inhibits the sleep on. The sleep on cells inhibits the wake on. So I think to understand the flip-flop switch model, we'll just like put, imagine this seesaw, like Dr. Patil is sitting around here. Dr. Ye is sitting around here. Dr. Carter is sitting around here. And then Dr. Oakley is sitting around here. And then let's imagine Dr. Stroll as the orexin. So if it's daytime, if the let's say Dr. Stroll is like, we clone Dr. Stroll. This is just an example for fellows understanding. So let's say Dr. Stroll, there's a lot of orexin and Dr. Stroll is the orexin. So one of Dr. Stroll's clone will go here. And so when there's two, kind of like stimulates the wake on cells. So it's going to be more, what's this? So the patient will be on the wakefulness state because this is down. The wake on cells are down. Same thing with this one. The REM off cells will be turned, will be activated, and there's no REM because there's the orexin stimulating the REM off cells. So just imagine in people with narcolepsy, when there's no orexin to stabilize both seesaw, what happens? It's always be in limbo, like doing like this. And so they'll be having sleep attacks, sleep fragmentation. During the times that they needed to sleep, they can't sleep. They're having arousals. During the times that they need to be awake, they cannot stay awake too because they're having sleep attacks. And then they're getting REM sleep, so REM in every time they go to sleep, whether it's daytime, nighttime. So this is the norm, what it looks like for the normal sleep-wake cycle. A normal sleep-wake cycle is characterized by consolidated wakefulness during the day and generally infrequent awakenings at night. But in narcolepsy sleep-wake cycle, the sleep-wake cycle isn't stable throughout the 24-hour period, whether it's awake or whether it's daytime or nighttime. So the sleep disorders, you probably know this, like we kind of like categorize them into six major classes. And there's the sleep breathing disorders, circadian rhythm, sleep related parasomnias, that's the abnormal behavior during sleep, and hypersomnia, the excessively sleepy, and the insomnia. So excessive sleepiness or hypersomnolence is basically sleepiness that occurs in a situation when an individual would usually be expected to be awake or alert, like falling asleep while driving, unexpected sleep attacks. This is totally different from being fatigued, though. So we need to make sure when we're seeing a patient complaining with excessive sleepiness, we need to make sure it's not fatigue, but it's really sleepiness. And there's also a difference between active versus passive sleepiness and subjective versus objective sleepiness. So how do we measure sleepiness? So subjective sleepiness is the Epworth sleepiness. We usually use the Epworth sleepiness scale or the Stanford sleepiness scale. And then the objective sleepiness are the MSLT and the MWT. There's also some psychomotor vigilance tests like the SART and the Osler sleep resistance test. So for the Epworth sleepiness scale, it kind of underestimates sometimes the severity of sleepiness. And it's widely used in research and clinical practice. It correlates moderately well with MSLT and MWT, but it correlates weakly with AHI or oxygen saturation. Test three tests reliability of Epworth sleepiness scale has not been well studied in healthy individuals. However, in patients with sleep apnea or narcolepsy, it appears to have an acceptable level of test-retest reliability in evaluating treatment response over time. That's why every time the patient comes in for follow-up, we usually get the Epworth sleepiness scale. And a significant improvement on the sleepiness would be suggested if the Epworth value kind of like dropped by at least two values before and after treatment. So this is the Epworth sleepiness scale. Like there's eight situations and we kind of like ask the patient, how likely are you to doze off on the following situations? And how do we interpret the Epworth sleepiness scale value? So 1 to 10 is usually normal range of sleepiness in healthy adults, 11 to 14 is mild, 15 to 17 is moderate, 18 to 24 is severe. And as the range on certain situations, usually sleep apnea patients would be ranging like 11 plus minus 2, house staff is like 17 plus minus 2, narcolepsy is like 19 plus minus 2. Some book says it's about 15 and above. Idiopathic hypersomnia range is 10 to 15 actually. And then the Stanford sleepiness scale, it's measuring the degree of sleepiness at a specific moment in time. Like we usually use this during MWT. So the difference between MSLT and MWT. So the MSLT is a validated objective test to measure the tendency to fall asleep, like while MWT measures the ability to stay awake. And so MSLT is used to diagnose narcolepsy or idiopathic hypersomnia, while MWT kind of monitor effectiveness of intervention like CPAP or stimulants. For the MSLT, overnight sleep study is required, but it's not required on MWT. Sleep diary, we usually take sleep diary to make sure that patient has adequate sleep to at least 2 weeks before the testing. Urine drug screen, we do that on the day of testing because we want to rule out drug-induced hypersomnolence. And then we give the patients like nap trials every 2 hours, 5 naps, each nap 20 minutes for MSLT, 4 naps for MWT, each nap 40 minutes. And the thing is the preparation for MSLT, if patients is already on stimulant, we're doing a retesting or something, or or to diagnose narcolepsy, but they've been on stimulant for something else. So we usually ask them to stop 3 to 5 days prior testing. If feasible, we ask them also to stop the antidepressants 2 weeks prior testing. That is if it's feasible, because some patients, you cannot really stop those things. And then for MWT, it's just stopping smoking and caffeine use 12 hours prior testing. We don't want to stop stimulants because we actually want to monitor the effectiveness of intervention in MWT. NAP is terminated when no, for MSLT, NAP is terminated when no sleep occurs after 20 minutes. If sleep occurs, we continue for additional 15 minutes because we want to look for the SOREM, the sleep onset REM period, which is REM, seeing a state, a REM stage within 15 minutes of sleep onset. And then the MWT, NAP is terminated when we have 3 consecutive epochs of N1 sleep or 1 epoch of any sleep stage or no sleep after 40 minutes. So indication for the MSLT is usually when the Epworth Sleepiness Scale or patient's history identifies subjective sleepiness that seems to be out of proportion to objective findings from a PSG. Diagnosis of narcolepsy or idiopathic hypersomnia is being considered. That's also an indication to order MSLT. When do we do a retest? So usually we're doing retest if initial test was affected by inappropriate study conditions, or results are ambiguous or uninterpretable, or tests failed to support diagnosis of narcolepsy despite strong clinical suspicion. Causes of hypersomnolence. So I put medications as the first one because sometimes we overlook the medications. Like patients presenting in sleep clinic, sometimes the patients will tell me like, oh, I have narcolepsy, even though there was no PSG MSLT done. So kind of like make sure for this is kind of like for the fellows, make sure that when somebody's complaining sleepiness, look at the medications first. For all you know, they are on a gabapentin for their neuropathy, or they're taking Belsomra for something else, and then now they're having hypersomnolence. And sleep deprivation can also be, and insufficient sleep syndrome can also be cause of hypersomnolence. Sleep apnea, whether it's untreated or adequately treated sleep apnea, there's what we call residual hypersomnia in patients with adequately treated sleep apnea. Circadian rhythm disorders can also cause like hypersomnolence, especially the shift work disorder. And last, the central disorders of hypersomnolence. That includes the narcolepsy, idiopathic hypersomnia, the Klein-Levin syndrome. And there's other secondary causes of hypersomnia, which like the medications, medical disorders, psychiatric illnesses. So the idiopathic hypersomnia, there's depending on which book you were reading, if the in ICSD version 2, they kind of like divided in IH into without long sleep time and with long sleep time. So the without long sleep time was 6 to 10 hours. More than 10 hours is like the long sleep time. But the ICSD version 3, the one that we're using, they kind of eliminate this 2 subtypes of IH, and then they just put them together. And then the Klein-Levin syndrome. So in the version 2 of the ICSD book, we actually have a separate hypersomnia disorder called menstrual-related hypersomnia. But now it's under Klein-Levin syndrome on the ICSD-3. It's just something to know. I mean, nice to know. So I'm going to talk about a case. This is a 22-year-old female presenting with excessive daytime sleepiness. Her Epworth is like 17. So the sleep-wake schedule was she goes to bed by 1 a.m. She watches online videos in bed prior to sleep onset, falls asleep by 2 a.m. She would wake up once briefly from sleep at night and had vivid dreams. Some nights she sleeps through the night. She would awaken with much effort at 6:30 a.m. on weekdays and will sleep until 10 a.m. on weekends. And then naps. She naps once daily for 1 to 2 hours, feels more rested after napping than waking up in the morning. Review of symptoms, she denies snoring, restless leg syndrome, and other parasomnias. She experienced sleep paralysis when waking up in the morning from naps. She had a minor car accident when she fell asleep behind the wheel, and she would uncontrollably slump when she fell asleep behind the wheel. She would uncontrollably slump over when she laughed hard and had smacked her head while seated at a dining table in this context. Past medical history, unremarkable. There's no history of head trauma or some vaccinations or H1N1. Past surgical history, she had tonsillectomy at age 3. Family history is unremarkable. Medication list, none. So what would be the likely diagnosis? So is this narcolepsy type 1, type 2, idiopathic hypersomnia, Klein-Levin, or possibly type 1 with insufficient sleep syndrome and inadequate sleep hygiene? Anybody from the fellows to try?
Orexin is unmuting.
There you go. All right, we got this now. So it's a medical student in the first year that's burning the candle at both ends and doesn't like to go to school. No, that's not the right diagnosis, is it? Okay. Oh, well, what is it? Fellows. A chorus of fellows. How about a trio of fellows? Can you say it all at once? What's the diagnosis? The last one.
Yes. Yeah, so the last one. Yeah, that's right. So the thing is, the reason why we think based clinical history that this is narcolepsy type 1 is because there was a history of cataplexy, which is often seen in narcolepsy type 1, but not in the other disorders of hypersomnolence. So features of cataplexy could be partial or general. And it could affect your face, neck, limbs, bilateral. Reflexes are usually absent or decreased in affected areas. Duration is seconds to minutes. Patients is usually fully conscious with full event recall. And the trigger is usually strong emotions like positive emotions, laughter, anticipation, or surprise. So it is strongly associated with narcolepsy type 1, but it can also be seen with other disorders like Niemann-Pick disease, type C, Angelman, Prader-Willi, and hypothalamic lesions. So in the same case, PSGM MSLT was ordered, and in the meantime, patient was counseled on sleep hygiene and sufficient sleep time, such as not using electronic devices 30 minutes before bedtime, maintaining regular sleep schedule to allow 7 to 8 hours sleep, and limiting daytime naps to less than 1 hour. And then there's also a 2-week sleep diary requested. Despite getting 8 to 9 hours of sleep, patients still reported severe sleepiness. PSG MSLT showed AHI of 1, MSL of 2.1, and 5 SOREM, including a nocturnal sleep onset REM period, meaning the overnight sleep study also had a SOREM. So plan was to start an alerting agent. Which of the following agents would you recommend for her? Can a fellow try on this?
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. No, dead silence. Stunned silence. What do you want to start with?
It's okay. So I think
there's no right answer here. It's all a back and forth. It's all cost benefit. What do you want to do? Which one? Come on, guys. Commit yourself. And then if you're wrong, you just sit there and why am I wrong? Right?
B.
B. They got B. A killer B. Whatever the insurance will pay for. Well, that'll be B. All
yeah.
right.
So before I discuss the answer, so we're going to go through all the medications. Oh. So alerting agents, what does it do to our body? It counteracts sleepiness. Indications could be for shift work disorder, central disorders of hypersomnolence like narcolepsy or IH, residual hypersomnolence in sleep apnea. So there's different types of alerting agents. There's the non-stimulating, which includes the non-stimulant wake promoting agents. That includes the caffeine, modafinil, solriamfetol, and pitolisant. Sodium oxybate is actually an alerting agent. It helps both with the excessive daytime sleepiness and cataplexy. And there's also the stimulants, which are derivatives of amphetamines. So before we go through that, I want to review something in our med school, like the FDA pregnancy categories and a basic pharmacology. So for category A, when we see category A, meaning controlled studies showed no risk. So that means there's well-controlled studies in pregnant women that failed to demonstrate risk to fetus. When we see category B, there's no evidence of risk in humans, but animal findings might show risk. Or it could be also no adequate human studies have been done yet, but animal findings are negative. If it's category C, risk cannot be ruled out. Human studies are lacking. Animal studies are either positive for fetal risk or lacking as well. However, potential benefits may justify potential risk. And then category D, positive evidence of risk. Category X is contraindicated. So for the basic pharmacology, just the affinity and the intrinsic activity. So the intrinsic, so affinity is like there's the agonist and antagonist. So they have the same affinity to a receptor, but then the intrinsic activity, it kind of like changes, it does something inside the cell, but the antagonist doesn't. The antagonist kind of like just sits on that receptor and prevents other substances to go bind on the receptor, okay? And so let's talk about each of the alerting agents. So sleepy and then caffeine. Life is short, enjoy your coffee. So for the caffeine, it's the most widely used and overly used at times. It's the most widely used wake promoting agent and overly used at times. It's readily available, accessible, most common wake promoting agent used, especially by shift workers and people who are not yet diagnosed who had undiagnosed cause of hypersomnolence. 12-ounce coffee is about 200 milligrams caffeine, and that's usually the max dose for pregnant females. And then pregnancy category is C. Caffeine actually has pregnancy category of C. That's interesting. Mechanism of action is it's an antagonist to the adenosine receptors, leading to attenuation of homeostatic sleep pressure. It reduces slow wave sleep duration and affects circadian regulated REM sleep. So this is adenosine and this is caffeine. Somewhat looks alike, but and then caffeine kind of like binds on the adenosine receptors. Because remember, adenosine is the one that contributes to the process S, the sleep pressure. So half-life of caffeine is usually 5 hours, but as with advancing age, it becomes longer, anywhere 8 to 14 hours. Excretion is hepatic, and it's metabolized by the cytochrome P450 isoenzyme and the cytochrome 1A2 with subsequent metabolites that includes paroxetine, theophylline, theobromine. So there's actually an inter-individual variation on the CYP1A2 activity. And because of this, these polymorphisms of the CYP1A2, this can result in slow metabolism of caffeine in some patients. So some patients are less likely tolerant to high doses of caffeine. And there's also differences on the adenosine receptor gene, which can also contribute to individual caffeine sensitivity. Because some patients will tell you, oh, caffeine doesn't affect me. I can still sleep like within 5 minutes in bed. So coffee-wise, so there's different brands here and This is just something nice to know, though. I noted that Starbucks has the highest amount of caffeine. And then in terms of like pop, the Mountain Dew apparently has the highest amount of caffeine. And there's the drip coffee and the brewed coffee. I think the drip has more sometimes. And then else. So the alerting agents. So these are the different prescription alerting agents. So there's these are the therapeutic dose. And then pregnancy category, so solriamfetol and pitolisant, FDA hasn't assigned any pregnancy category for that, but most alerting agents are pregnancy category C, except for sodium oxybate, which is B. And then approved for kids is pitolisant, sodium oxybate, Adderall, methylphenidate, and the lisdexamfetamine. DEA schedule, you probably know this. Modafinil, armodafinil are four, schedule four. Pitolisant is not a controlled substance. Sodium oxybate is schedule three, while the rest of the amphetamine derivatives are two. So the methylphenidate, this is interesting. In Australia, their FDA there is categorizing this as pregnancy category D. But in US, it's actually at C right now. Mechanism of action. I know this looks like a busy slide, but I'm going to have some pictures to explain it further later. Let's go to the picture. So it says here, so this is the presynaptic neuron. So usually when the norepinephrine, let's say the norepinephrine or the dopamine or serotonin, those are the monoaminergic neurotransmitters. So when they are made, they are usually placed in a vesicle, and there's what we call the VMAT. Okay, the VMAT, it's a vesicle transporter. And so the amphetamines usually binds to the vesicle. I think there's a big better picture here. So the amphetamine, so actually the amphetamine diffuses into the vesicle, causing the dopamine, norepinephrine, or serotonin release into the cytoplasm. But amphetamine actually, it diffuses into the vesicle, causing all the monoamine release into the cytoplasm. And then it also blocks the reuptake of this vesicle because it blocks that the VMAT so that it's not getting reuptake. And then on the other hand, it also blocks the reuptake here on the membrane. Okay, there's a membrane here. There's a reuptake transporter for the neurotransmitter. The amphetamine also blocks that one. So amphetamine actually is multitasking here. It diffuses to cause release of those monoamines, and then it blocks the reuptake. So that way, you're gonna have a lot of the neurotransmitters in the synapse. Now, on the other hand, the methylphenidate, it blocks the reuptake of norepinephrine and dopamine here. So that way, anything that was already purged out into the synapse, it will just stay in the synapse because it's not getting reuptake, right? And then, so the modafinil, on the other hand, it has different proposed mechanism of action. They said it can increase the norepinephrine and dopamine because it also blocks the reuptake inhibitor transporter there on the cell membrane. And it decreases GABA, increases glutamate. Indirectly, it increases orexin and histamine, thereby promoting increased wakefulness and alertness. On the other hand, the histamine, I mean the pitolisant. The pitolisant is an antagonist to the histamine 3 receptors. So there's actually a lot of histamine receptors in the body. Histamine 1 is seen in the lungs and in the skin. And histamine 2 receptor is in your stomach. And then histamine 3 is in the CNS. There's also histamine 1 in the CNS, by the way. Histamine 3, histamine 2. And then histamine 4 is in white blood cells. They promote chemotaxis. So anyways, so what happens is, remember, histamine is being enclosed in a vesicle. There's the VMAT again there that regulates that the the transport of these monoamines in a vesicle, and then it also regulates the release of the neurotransmitters into the synapse. So the histamine, there's also a receptor, H3 receptor. The purpose of this H3 receptor is actually to reuptake the histamine. But since the pitolisant kind of blocks that, it's not reuptake. I mean, it's not taken up again by the presynaptic neuron, so it stays again in the synapse. And then the sodium oxybate, on the other hand, it binds. This is just because the real mechanism of action is still unknown. So this is like a proposed mechanism of action. They said it might be binding with the GABA-B receptor and the GHB receptor, and thereby increasing slow wave sleep and improving the daytime sleepiness. So in terms of like pharmacokinetics, time to peak is 2 to 4 hours for both modafinil, and it's usually delayed 1 hour with food. And then half-life is 4 to 5 hours for modafinil. Armodafinil is 15 hours. Excretion is by the liver. Solriamfetol, it's 2 hours with fasting, 1 hour with high fat meal. So it's actually fast, more absorbed faster if you're eating high fat meal with solriamfetol. Unlike the amphetamines, usually the amphetamines, when you the absorption is kind of like delayed with food. And then both of them, solriamfetol, pitolisant, are renally excreted. Sodium oxybate is interesting. Excretion is actually pulmonary. And then the amphetamines, they're all renally excreted. Adverse effects. So the common adverse effects are headache, nausea. For the modafinil, it's headache, nausea, insomnia, dry mouth, and diarrhea. Armodafinil is headache, upper respiratory tract infection, dizziness, nausea, sinusitis. Solriamfetol is usually headache, decreased appetite, insomnia, nausea, chest discomfort, anxiety, constipation, dry mouth, and palpitations. Pitolisant, again, headache is the most common side effect. Insomnia, weight gain, some weight gain, nausea, and anxiety. The rare adverse effects is for modafinil. Armodafinil is severe rash like SJS, QT prolongation in pitolisant. I didn't see anything right now for the solriamfetol. The sodium oxybate, the most common side effect is morning sedation, nausea, dizziness. Some people will have nocturnal enuresis or sleepwalking, worsening of sleep, disordered breathing, tremor, constipation, weight loss, chest discomfort, headache. And then the rare serious adverse side effects are confusion, severe sedation, coma, depression, suicidal ideation, psychosis. For the amphetamine derivatives, the common adverse effects is irritability, anxiety, nausea, weight loss, insomnia, jitteriness. And then the rare serious side effects are psychosis, mania, seizure, priapism, and cardiovascular effects. Monitoring wise, so modafinil, armodafinil, we tell them monitor blood pressure. And the most important part is the enzyme induction, the CYP, cytochrome 3A4 and cytochrome 3A5 enzyme induction, because they're inducers of these enzymes. So modafinil are inducers of these enzymes. That's why they impair effectiveness of steroidal contraceptives, and exposure during pregnancy increases risk of congenital malformation. So if you're going to give prescribe modafinil or modafinil to female patients, you have to remember to talk about having them like get two types of contraception. And then solriamfetol monitor heart rate and blood pressure, pitolisant monitor QT, sodium oxybate, not to be used with alcohol, sedatives, or hypnotics. You get it in a central pharmacy with enrollment in REMS program. There's potential for diversion and abuse. Overdose can result in seizures, coma, or death. The amphetamine derivatives due to insomnia, final dose of the day is no later than 46 hours before bedtime. So that's around 3 a.m. We tell patients usually 3 p.m. I mean, and then monitor weight, blood pressure, caution if family or personal history of cardiac arrhythmias, addictive potential at higher doses, and potential for tolerance or abuse. Now, regarding the AASM strength of recommendation in adult population. So for the narcolepsy, the ones that have strong strength, the strength of recommendation is strong, is modafinil, pitolisant, sodium oxybate, and solriamfetol. And the reasons why they have strong is because there are several RCTs that says there's improvement of excessive daytime sleepiness. For cataplexy, that's spitolisant and sodium oxybate. There's strong strength of recommendation, strong recommendation. For disease severity, all four, again, quality of life is modafinil and solriamfetol. Conditional strength of recommendation are armodafinil, dextroamphetamine, and methylphenidate. Now, on other central disorders of hypersomnolence, like idiopathic hypersomnia, only modafinil has strong. The strength recommendation is strong. The rest are conditional. Klein-Levin syndrome, lithium has conditional strength of recommendation. And then hypersomnia secondary to medical conditions. So everything actually have conditional, armodafinil, modafinil, and sodium oxybate have conditional strength of recommendation. For post-traumatic hypersomnia, it's also conditional for armodafinil and modafinil. And genetic disorders genetic disorders associated with primary central nervous system, somnolence, or CNS lesions, they're both condition. Modafinil has conditional strength of recommendation. In pediatric population, modafinil and sodium oxybate have conditional strength of recommendation. So going back to question number two, so plan to start an alerting agent. So here's the thing though, the way I, because when you look at it, this patient has cataplexy and excessive daytime sleepiness. And literally, in order to target both the excessive daytime sleepiness and cataplexy, either pitolisant or sodium oxybate would be the, what's this, the recommended alerting agents in an ideal setting. I know in insurance, you cannot get pitolisant. And so, I mean, in real life, you cannot get pitolisant for the patient or sodium oxybate unless they failed modafinil first, right? Yeah, but in an ideal setting, like for board exam purposes, the reason why I pick pitolisant here is because pitolisant over sodium oxybate is because on the sleep wake schedule, the patient actually has only like one brief awakening in the middle of the night. She doesn't have like disrupted nighttime sleep, and some nights she actually sleeps through the night. So because the thing is sodium oxybate, remember sodium oxybate increases low wave sleep. So if this patient actually was waking up a lot in the middle of the night from her narcolepsy, then sodium oxybate would be the most appropriate answer. So these are the ongoing research trials for solriamfetol. Sharp trial is effect in cognitive health of OSA patients. And there's also like testing the solriamfetol in other diseases like Parkinson's, chronic fatigue, idiopathic hypersomnia to see if it will improve the excessive daytime sleepiness. Sustained trial is solriamfetol to treat excessive daytime sleepiness in shift work disorder. Pitolisant, there's also a lot of ongoing research trial like use in IH as an add-on to sodium oxybate. That's the Harmony 4. and other disorders like alcohol use disorder, myotonic dystrophy, Prader-Willi. There's also the PEACE study that's pitolisant effects on affect and cognition. So there's a lot of, bottom line, there's a lot of ongoing research trials right now that are worth looking into in the future, because we might have more options to give for people with IH. So take home points is self-reported sleepiness is generally subjective and imprecise. Hence, we combine subjective tests, objective tests like MSLT and clinical history to determine the degree and cause of sleepiness. Do not immediately label sleepy patients as narcoleptics. There are other causes of sleepiness aside from narcolepsy. The reason I put this as part of take home points, because I see, like, I have some new patients that are referred to me telling me they have narcolepsy when they never had any symptoms of cataplexy or other things like sleep paralysis. They never had PSG, MSLT. It's because their primary care said, oh, you're sleepy, you have narcolepsy. So it's kind of, what's this? It's too early to label patients as narcolepsy just because of the excessive daytime sleepiness. So we have to combine clinical history, subjective tests, and objective tests. And then when starting a stimulant, need to consider research evidence, side effect profile, and drug-drug interaction, as well as patient's clinical condition. These are the references. And this is the Aurora Borealis in Cleveland. Last week, my husband and I drove to Cleveland just to see Aurora Borealis. This is in Rock and Roll Hall of Fame area.